London-listed Kefi Minerals has just added the Tulu Kapi asset, previously owned by Nyota, to its portfolio of interests. It already has interests in Saudi Arabia. Harry Adams is chairman. Harry, welcome. This £4.5 million purchase of a 75% stake in Tulu Kapi from Nyota, I don't know how much of a surprise it was to investors, so I know the history in Tulu Kapi, but what was the interest for Kefi in this asset?
Well, it's hand in glove with the geology that we've developed a real expertise in, the Arabian-Nubian Shield, straddles both sides of the Red Sea, so it was, you know, really great fit. Secondly, it allows us to move straight into development with an advanced asset with reserves, which really stumbled in the home stretch for financing, and we felt after spending some months in there that we could put it on the road fairly quickly.
Nyota found it difficult to make anything out of this, and I know sentiment came on board, and in fact they ended up failing in their bid to oust the management of Nyota, and they didn't want to take over the asset. Why was this of interest? I mean, when you've got so many parties seemingly unable to make it work.
Yeah, well, it all comes down to the numbers, the geology, and that's where it starts. And we've been in there since the middle of last year, and we've done our homework intensely. We formed our own view. We could redesign the mine, that's the bottom line, by not focusing on a bulk mining approach to the ore body. We were far more conservative. We believe a far more robust mine plan. Instead of assuming $1,500 gold, assume $1,000 gold for the banking case, and make sure it works robustly. And we're just operators making sure that it stands up from day one.
Okay, well, the follow-up question to that obviously has got to be the cost involved here, because the DFS has got to cost something approaching, for the capex at least, of something approaching $300 million. But I think you come up with a figure of sub $150
million. Yeah, well, effectively, it's not rocket science. All we've done is to say, instead of trying to bulk mine the thing, let's actually maximise how much money we make. And instead of mining 2 million tonnes a year, mine closer to 1 million tonnes a year of ore. At the same time, what that does is dramatically reduce the stripping ratio. So the waste ratio is reduced even further. So the amount of material that will get mined will be vastly reduced. The capex required by downscaling, it will be vastly reduced. And yet we'll still get something like 80% of the gold that was being targeted before by more selectively mining. At the same time, we do emphasise that this is the startup case, starting up, you know, safer and more robustly with a higher profit margin. But there's no reason why we can't open it up further and go down into the deeps, the underground potential, if the gold price runs up.
So when's the resource going to be updated? When will we know more?
We've had the team in there for some months. We've only took possession of the asset 6 weeks ago, but we've had people on the ground for some months, and the resources update will be within the next month. We'll do so again with the final mine plan in the summer, in the northern summer. We're moving as fast as we can.
And that'll be the point when the new DFS comes out, will it?
Yeah, it'll come out around third, fourth quarter. It depends on how fast we can push it. But so far we're heading the direction of no later than fourth quarter.
Have you got enough money to take you through to that point?
That's what we raised in December, enough money to start paying the back taxes that the previous owner hadn't paid to the Ethiopian government, and that was all formalised with the government recently, and to make sure we can refine the DFS so that we can trigger development from thereafter.
What's Ethiopia like to work in, from your experience?
Well, so I don't claim to be an expert, because I'm a sort of a new kid on the block with Jeff and the team, but I've got to say it's been refreshingly constructive as a regime, regulatory authorities and government people. And I suppose it's partly because Ethiopia is very much pro-development, enjoying 10% GDP growth as a country, which is quite something given that it's the size, geographical scale of France and Spain combined, and 90 million population. But I think for us, the more important point is that it had been through government approval, this project, and it formed part of the government's growth development plan, centrally controlled, holding the ministries accountable for their promises to the cabinet. And the community had been prepared for the project, the government had prepared the community for this project to go ahead, and then it failed to get financed by the previous owner. So the government felt let down, and then when we turned up after we got to know them, you know, it wasn't very difficult to win their support because they just wanted to get it back on track.
Talking about financing, where do you go after the summer? And you've got that DFS out. You've obviously got to raise more money somehow.
Well,
what options do you see are open to you?
Well, there's really two principal options. There's a couple of other secondary type options. Principal options that are sort of bleedingly obvious are the conventional, you know, Western project finance specialist banks for project finance. Combined with the London equity capital markets for the equity component. That's what I'd call the vanilla approach. The second obvious choice is that the largest investors, foreign capital in Ethiopia, are the Chinese, and they're very keen on gold assets in particular in Africa, and Ethiopia is very much on their radar. So we've already been to China and already activated some discussions there to have that as a choice as well, both for equity and debt. And there are some secondary choices like the private equity markets and that sort of thing. So we'll develop a number of choices so that at least we can optimise it from shareholders' viewpoint.
Up until November, until investors learned of your this interest in Tulu Kapi, you've been a company that had been focused in Saudi Arabia. How does this dovetail with that asset, and where is the Saudi Arabian business at the moment?
Well, Saudi Arabia is the same geology. It's the Arabian-Nubian Shield, same rocks. So when our geologists move from one to the other, they're using the lessons and the data from one to help with the other. So that's an important point. The second thing is that the development team can straddle both projects. We've made a discovery in Saudi Arabia, but it's not as advanced as Tulu Kapi, and it's not as big as Tulu Kapi. It may become, but it's not at this stage. Saudi Arabia is really opening up a province. We pegged a lot of ground there, and the permits are coming through, albeit slowly. And it's really the opening of a province. It's sort of opening Pandora's box, you know, the exciting potential.
Yeah,
and
yeah.
And we don't know what it is, but it's very exciting. But Tulu Kapi strategically fits perfectly because it's within the same belt of country, different sovereign risk, but allows us to get into cash flow, dividends, you know, funding our own operations from within, and that changes the whole complexion of the risk profile.
Harry, it's a pleasure to talk to you. Thanks for joining us. Harry Adams, he's the chairman of Kefi Minerals.